We love animals, but it's no secret that they don't always love us back. From eating our crops and livestock to spreading diseases, there are plenty of times where humans want to keep the rest of the natural world at arm's length. But a lot of the time, these efforts don't exactly work according to plan. So from declaring a literal war to shooting at them from helicopters, here are just a few ways we've tried and failed to keep wild animals in check. Our first example of animal control gone awry is a historical tale called the Emu War. Yes, really, and by all accounts, this war reached Wile E. Coyote versus Roadrunner levels of hijinks. The Emu War began in 1932 when Australians became frustrated by a massive flock of roughly 20,000 migratory emus eating their crops, which was far too many for the farmers to control on their own. So they had to call in reinforcements, specifically the Australian military, and these soldiers came armed with machine guns. First blood was drawn in Western Australia at the end of 1932. A group of men were sent to flush the emus toward the gunners, but the birds all fled into a patch of timber instead. The gunners opened fire, but the first rounds fell short. All in all, they only managed to cull a handful of emus, so 5 down, 19,995 to go, I guess? The men quickly realized that they weren't dealing with dense hordes of birds, and the thousands of emus were way more scattered, making them much harder to kill en masse. By now, the emus were apparently getting wise, and some people claimed that the birds would designate sentries to alert the rest of the flock when those pesky humans showed up. The humans, however, were not getting wise. In one skirmish, soldiers pursuing the birds with a mounted gun didn't fire a single shot as their gunner was almost flung from the vehicle due to the bumpy terrain. In another attempt, the unfortunate driver ran over an emu that then jammed itself in the steering mechanism, causing the car to spiral out of control and crash. Eventually, the military got their act together and found better strategies to cull the flocks, but it turned out that this wasn't actually all that great. See, the panicking emus wound up trampling through the farmland and more crops than they'd been eating, meaning that farmers lost even more of their yields. The war ended later that year at harvest time, since there was no more wheat to tempt the emus. All in all, this disastrous emu culling effort turned out to be a bit bird-brained. Emus aren't the only wild animals that pose a danger to our crops, and in this case, these creatures are big enough to pose a threat to humans too. As majestic and regal as they are, elephants are difficult neighbors to have. They can destroy our crops, and they're responsible for more human fatalities than most carnivores in rural areas of Africa and India. Which is why, in populations that are not under threat, some people have tried to cull elephant herds, and it hasn't gone well. In Kruger National Park in South Africa, thousands of elephants were culled between 1967 and 1996 due to a belief that elephants were damaging the vegetation and reducing biodiversity, although that idea has since been criticized. These culls focused on the mature adults in the herds, which seemed to have some unintended consequences. A lot of those younger or orphaned elephants were transported to Pilanesberg National Park, and when compared to unculled groups of elephants, the cull survivors seemed to lack vital social cues and even struggled to interpret social cues among their herds. This doesn't just make them awkward at dinner parties. Lacking social skills may make them more dangerous to humans too, and at least 5 nature preserves that were given cull survivors recorded that their rescue elephants ended up killing people. Not only that, the Pilanesberg elephants also killed dozens of rhinos in the 10 years after their arrival. So why does killing some elephants turn the rest into juvenile delinquents? We think that when the older animals are shot and family groups were left incomplete, the surviving youngsters were essentially kids without a babysitter. See, normally the younger bulls are prevented from breeding by the older males, since female elephants like more mature mates. But without the calmer bulls around, younger males had access to females and would start reproducing earlier than usual. That would send them into a sort of breeding season testosterone spike called must at younger ages, while they're still all immature and brash. So it's possible that a fair amount of this aggression came from all that excess testosterone. When the park rangers reintroduced several mature bull elephants into the population, the killing stopped and the misbehaving teens calmed down. We now know that older bulls have a calming influence on younger males that gets them to behave a lot better, so at least we learned a little something. After all, we don't need any more bullies. Unless you're a regular elephant hunter or 100-year-old emu war veteran, you may not have had any personal experience with those first two nuisance animals. But there's a much bigger chance that at some point in your life, you've had a run-in with a rat. They eat our food, chew our wires, and have been known to spread the occasional plague. If you've ever had to deal with a rat infestation, you may have put down traps or even poison to keep them in check, although maybe you should reconsider that last one. One of the most common commercial rat poisons is a drug called warfarin, which works as an anticoagulant. In other words, it prevents blood clotting. It also does that for humans, so warfarin is also a common medication for people who are at risk of dangerous blood clots. But in rodents, we ramp up the dose so high that it causes fatal internal bleeding, because, say it with me now, the dose makes the poison! Warfarin-based rat poisons first hit the market in 1948, and they're still a common product. That's a whole lot of years of warfarin exposure, and if you breed as fast as a rodent, that's a lot of generations for natural selection to kick in. Just 10 years after the first warfarin-based poisons were sold, some people recorded the first cases of warfarin resistance in rats. And since then, warfarin resistance has become a common adaptation in rats all over the world. See, warfarin works by inhibiting the way that vitamin K interacts with the coagulation process. But rats who develop resistance to warfarin are able to use a different enzyme in the vitamin K clotting process that isn't as vulnerable to warfarin's disruptive effects. Those initial warfarin resistant rats did end up with some side effects, like vitamin K deficiencies and lower growth rates, at least at first. But a paper in 1993 found that they'd overcome that hurdle too. Not only did warfarin-resistant rats not have these deficiencies, they were actually larger than non-resistant rats, even in environments without frequent warfarin exposure. We essentially made super rats. As you'd expect, that started a pharmacological arms race, where researchers developed even more lethal substances, creatively called super warfarins. And these did work. Until they didn't. They'd speculated that rodents could become resistant to super warfarin eventually, and sure enough, rats started showing resistance to the new drugs back in the 2000s. Which means that our go-to rodent killer is really just helping make super rats even superer. So maybe a trap with some cheese really is the better idea. I can't imagine how rats would become immune to cheese. But also, all science needs funding, including us, so here's a quick ad.
Thanks to our presidents of science, McLaren Stanley and Charlie Stanley, for supporting this SciShow video. Some presidents move money away from science, but the presidents of science use their budget to keep it accessible to everyone. For over a year, McLaren Stanley and Charlie Stanley have financially supported SciShow so that you can watch it for free if it's not within your budget to contribute. And if it is, you can join in the effort to keep science a part of our lives at patreon.com/scishow.
Next, let's move up the food chain and talk about what happens when carnivores become nuisances, and how we've also failed to solve those problems. Specifically, we're talking about jackals and coyotes. Humanity usually ends up at war with small dogs basically wherever we overlap. Big dogs too, but we'll get to them. Fox hunting in the UK, shooting jackals in South Africa, and all the nasty ways that we try to keep coyote populations down in the US are usually done in the name of lowering livestock predation. Problem is, it doesn't work. The issue comes from who exactly you're killing. For instance, one study from 2015 looked at the effects of culling black-backed jackals in South Africa. They found that in stable, non-hunted areas, the breeding adults controlled a sizable territory, with some sub-adults off at the fringes who didn't have enough territory to breed. But when farmers shot those breeding adults, that territory would become vacant, and nature abhors a vacuum. All the younger jackals rushed into the open territory and started breeding all at once. For some reason, these young jackals end up reproducing earlier in their life than the older breeding pairs would. So where you once had a single breeding pair, you now have a lot more jackals than you bargained for. And it's not only jackals. One study from South Carolina looked at changes in coyote populations in response to culling and found that, similarly, as more coyotes are trapped, the overall population in an area increases over time. But this increase isn't the result of more breeding. Instead, the nearby younger coyotes realize that there's territory up for grabs and move in. Unless coyote cull programs are enacted over massive stretches of land, their research shows that coyote populations in areas with trapping programs will rebound in just a few months. And this pattern applies to bigger carnivores too, like cougars. One study from British Columbia found that from 1979 to 2008, increased cougar hunting led to even more dangerous encounters between cougars and people. When a mature male cougar gets shot, younger males will move into that territory, like we saw with the jackals and coyotes. And those young cougars happen to be the ones most likely to pick a fight with any hairless apes wandering around. They use human-dominated areas more, move around more while doing so, and are more likely to hunt livestock too. So it's probably best to let these sleeping dogs and cougars lie. Now, while a lot of these other animals have at least seemed kinda dangerous, these next guys are so stinking adorable that it's hard to picture why they'd be a problem for anybody. But there has been a long time beef between badgers and cattle farmers, at least in the UK. And it's not because they eat the cows, because how the heck would they even do that? Instead, the problem is that they infect them. In the UK, badgers are a carrier of a disease called bovine tuberculosis, or BTB. Badger culling has been a part of BTB control efforts in the UK since 1973, but it took a while for anybody to actually do a study to see if it was working or not. So in 1998, the government launched a randomized cull to see if killing badgers would help reduce BTB prevalence in the United Kingdom, which found that badger culling did basically nothing to stop the spread. Despite this, the government started another culling campaign in 2013, mainly in the south and southwest of England, with at least 140,000 badgers killed by the end of 2020. One study found that while there was a 23% drop in rates of BTB in the culled areas, rates of BTB in neighboring non-cull areas went up by about 25%. Another found that after 5 years of culling, there was an almost 30% drop in BTB rates, but these effects disappeared after just 4 years, or even less in some places. Overall, they found that BTB rates would fluctuate with or without culling, and a later study in 2022 also found that badger culling made no meaningful contribution to disease spread in the UK. And the reason why culling doesn't work to solve our badger problems is basically the polar opposite of what happens after that earlier carnivore culling. Instead of moving into culled areas, the problem is that these badgers move out. Badgers in the cull areas increased their home ranges by 61% and wandered nearly 40% farther from their set, or den, each night. Plus, badgers from culled populations typically visited around 45% more fields per month in their nightly voyages than those from non-culled groups. So they were more likely to infect both cattle and other badgers during and after the cull had finished. One of the studies found the cull costs 2 to 3 times more than the amount you'd save by reducing BTB spread in cattle. Which means we should all stop badgering them now, okay? Okay, so this last one may be the most metal attempt at population control I've ever heard, which is a shame since it also backfired hilariously. Due to severe habitat decline stemming from logging and oil pipelines, Canadian boreal caribou have been in trouble for a while. So to fix it, people should probably stop logging and drilling in their habitats. And that's what the Canadian government did. Oh, sorry, they didn't do that? What did they do instead? Oh, they shot gray wolves from helicopters. Since gray wolves are known to snack on the occasional caribou, the thought process was that by reducing the population of their predators, you'd bolster the caribou's numbers. And apparently this was the most humane method that they'd considered for reducing gray wolf populations, which really makes you wonder what the other options were. Between 2017 and 2020, helicopter snipers shot 92 wolves in northern Alberta, Canada, and this kinda worked until the wolves developed their own countermaneuvers. Turns out those wolves didn't like being shot at, and they began changing their behavior to essentially make themselves impossible to target. The survivors preferred thick areas of dense forest where they couldn't be followed, and avoided the logging roads where they were sitting ducks. All in all, they got a lot harder to kill. Their new homes are pretty great too. There's plentiful prey in the thick areas the wolves now hide in, so it's likely that their population will recover relatively quickly. And if they teach their young their chopper dodging ways, then they're going to be very hard to handle indeed. Oddly enough, this may be good for all those caribou after all. See, the changes that came from all that logging and drilling may have made things worse for caribou, but they also made things better for moose, the wolves' preferred prey. The researchers proposed that by reducing moose populations in caribou habitats to historical levels, they can encourage wolves to pick more moosey, less caribou-y homes. Who knows, maybe this year we'll make an update video with the wild way the moose are fighting back. All of these stories go to show that when we get fancy and try to outsmart Mother Nature, she usually has a clap back at the ready. Here's hoping that we learn something from these super rats so we don't end up with, like, super duper rats or anything.